So we're continuing our core value sermon series. Seven core values. We've covered R, which is relationship with God, P, perseverance, and we're at W. And by now you figured out what that word is, right?
No.
All right. Computer. Yeah, genius. And the passage today, we're looking at a message that Christ sent to the church in Pergamum. So if you look at here, you'll see Pergamum is gone, disappeared. All right, let's look at Pergamum. It's right there. See there? Right there? Pergamum. And we talked about Sardis last week, and then Smyrna last week here, and then Ephesus here. Ephesus talked about relationship with God, Smyrna, we talked about perseverance, now we're in Pergamum, okay? And the core value today is the Word of God, okay? The Word of God. When I was a sophomore in high school, any sophomores here in high school? Sophomore?
Oh,
you Canadians, we need a little vocabulary learning, all right? It's 10th grade, grade 10, sophomore. Okay. When I was in 10th grade, I had a red 1978 Pontiac Trans Am. It was perfect. It was more than perfect. It had raw power, 6.6 liters of engine. To give you perspective, my current SUV, the GMC, is 3.8 liters. Okay, so it had twice the size of that. It had a sunroof, white leather interior. It had customized plates. The license plate said Red Ghost in the back. So every time I smoked, they would be like, man, there goes the Red Ghost. But most importantly, it had a kicking Alpine radio system, right? 6x9s in the back. And I used to put, you know, I used to play Sir Mix-a-Lot. You guys know Sir Mix-a-Lot? My posse's on Broadway, me and Kid Station, home away from home. All right, you guys are too young to know that song. It's way back in the day. Yeah, I used to be like, my posse's on Broadway. It was just perfect. But I thought I could make it better. I thought I could make the sound system just a little bit better by adding bigger and better 6-inch speakers on the front doors. So I took out the old speakers and I put in the new ones. And then I realized I had to wire it. Wiring was a little bit confusing. I tried for about 30 minutes and I went back inside the house to take a break. And lo and behold, my mom walks in and says, Jen, your car is on fire. I'm like, Mom, you crazy. What do you mean my car is on fire? The Red Ghost? My Red Ghost? But just to make sure, I looked outside. Sure enough, there were flames coming out the window. I was like, oh no. I went outside, the fire ambulance came, and they actually pried. They couldn't get the hood open, so they used the crowbar to bend the hood. They put it out, and after, you know, when I looked in, you know, the inside was just all melted like a toasted marshmallow. A perfectly nice car was ruined because I wanted to make it even more better. No longer could it give me joy rides. No longer could it get me to the market. No longer could it play Sir Mix-a-Lot. Still Broadway. You guys want to see what that car looked like? Some are like, ooh. Some are like, whoa. Mixed reactions here. Yeah, that was it. But there are things we just should not try to change. It's perfect the way it is. One of those things that we should not change is the Word of God. The Bible says, the law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. Psalm 97. This God, His way is perfect. The Word of the Lord proves true. He is a shield for all those who take refuge in Him. We should not try to add to the gospel, to the Word of God. And the reason why is because the Word of God is perfect to save us. And when I'm talking about the Word of God, I'm also talking about the gospel, the overall message. The Word of God refers to the Bible, the specific you know, words in the Bible, it also means the overall general message of the gospel that saves us. Okay? That's what I mean by the Word of God. Now, I'm also talking about Jesus, who is the Word of God. The Word of God, it encompasses all these things. Okay? And the gospel, it's good news, isn't it? It's good news. It has something for us, some good news for us, to give us life, to give us joy, to save us from our sins. When we talk about the gospel, we talk about Jesus who saved us once and for all from all our sins to give us abundant and eternal life. It's good news. There's nothing more that needs to be added to it. The problem is that we think we need more than the gospel in our life to be satisfied. We need more. We look for things in our life and in the world to add to the gospel to make us happier. If we could just avoid that, avoid adding to the good news, then Jesus will be able to bless you and give you and help you to experience the life that the good news actually promises. The reason why the gospel is not powerful in our lives is because we're trying to add stuff to it. If we just avoid that, the gospel will do what it's supposed to do, which is to give you life, to give you hope, and give you joy, give you power in your life to be the kind of people God wants you to be. Jesus will give you contentment, true contentment. True contentment, true satisfaction, and true peace. The peace that the world cannot give. You know that, just like when you're at a lake by yourself, you know, like, just looking at the land, like, oh, there's just so much peace here. Away from all the mess, right? And the gospel is good news because it's supposed to satisfy our deepest longing. The deepest longing in our soul to give us peace. It's supposed to give us true joy. But in order for the gospel to be the gospel, you must trust only in Him. In the gospel, in Jesus Christ. The moment you add anything to it, it no longer becomes the gospel. Okay? Now, the problem in the church in Pergamum that Christ is speaking, the problem was this. This was the problem. The church in Pergamum was adding to the gospel. Some people felt that Christ was not enough for their salvation. So they started to teach that they had to do more, that they had to seek other gods by eating food sacrificed to idols. Okay, and let's look at the verse. So Jesus says, "But I have a few things against you. You have some there who hold the teachings of Balaam, who taught Balak to put a stumbling block before the sons of Israel, so that they might eat food sacrificed to idols and practice sexual immorality." Okay? And the teaching here that happened in Pergamum is compared to Balaam's teaching, okay, who taught Balak to put a stumbling block before the sons of Israel to eat food sacrificed to idols. Now, we need to understand what this is, okay? Balaam's teaching, okay? Here where it says, Balaam taught Balak to put a stumbling block, right? The stumbling block here, in Greek, is scandalon, and that's where we get the word scandalous, okay? And it literally means a baiting stick of a bird's trap. It's like a bait, okay? And so the word is used to mean a snare, a trap, a stumbling block, which causes or entices a person to fall or to fall into sin. And that's what Balaam did. And how did he do that? What he advised the king of Moab to do was to have foreign women to enter the camp of Israel and to entice them and to follow them to have sexual immoral, you know, acts, and also to worship other idols. Okay? To worship idols. So the people in the church of Pergamum were basically teaching others to commit idolatry. Okay? Idolatry. Idolatry is worshiping anything else that is not God. Idolatry is seeking happiness outside of God. Idolatry is the substitute for a true God and for the gospel of Christ. And it's not confined only in the ancient world, idolatry. It happens today. Richard Keys in the book, No God But God, says this: as the main category to describe unbelief, the idea is highly sophisticated, drawing together the complexities of motivation in individual psychology, the social environment, and also the unseen world. Idols are not just on pagan altars, but in well-educated human hearts and minds. And Tim Keller of Redeemer Church also observes this: why do we lie, or fail to love, or break our promises, or live selfishly? Of course, the general answer is because we are weak and sinful, but the specific answer is that there is something besides Jesus Christ that we feel we must have to be happy. Something that is more important to our heart than God. Something that is enslaving our heart through inordinate desires. That's idolatry. So, idolatry is in our hearts too, and it's a substitute for the gospel. And the problem with idolatry is that it does not deliver what it promises. It is like imitation sugar. You ever try, those imitation sugar? You know, it's kind of sweet, but it leaves a bad aftertaste, right? It's not the same thing. Or Diet Coke, right? It doesn't taste like Coke. It just tastes like, I don't know what it tastes like. It's just Coke-ish. It's not the real thing. And in the same way, idolatry, anything other than the gospel, it promises to bring happiness, but it doesn't. And that's why it's a scandalon. It's a snare. And it's a stumbling block to attain the blessings of God, which is true happiness and lasting happiness, which can only be found in the gospel. Therefore, Jesus opposes the teaching in Pergamum and says, if you don't repent, I'm going to come and I'm going to have to change you with the word sword in my mouth. Okay? Because Jesus knows the tremendous blessing that the people are missing out on. Okay? They're looking to other things. Now, there are two ways that idolatry takes shape in the human heart. Okay? And the theologian Ferguson describes it as non-identical twins of the same womb. Non-identical twins of the same womb. Number one is that you try to create the happiness for yourself. You work hard at it. Okay? So the Pergamon Christians, they were looking to sacrifice to idols. And they were working. They were trying to gain more blessing from another god. Okay? I said, we need more blessing. We need to do this in order to gain more blessing, to be more happy. And one of the ways that we do that is money. We work hard. We work hard for the money. You know that song? Man, I'm just dating myself with all these songs, aren't I? And it's, I think, Janet, I don't know, I forget. Anyways, we work hard for money, right? And money is definitely an idol, and we think that money will bring us happiness and contentment. And people want money to control their world, right? And such people, they don't spend money, like me. Others want money to make themselves more beautiful, right? Or whatever. And so that kind of people, they spend money. The problem is money doesn't lead to happiness, okay? According to a study, America is regarded as one of the most unhappy nations on earth, okay? But they have the highest standard of living, okay? The happiest people turned out where? Nigeria, happiest people. Okay, if you want to be happy, go to Nigeria. But they have the lowest standard of living. I don't know how they did the study, but that's true. And there was an article in the Wall Street Journal titled Richest Country, Saddest People, Any Coincidence? That was the title by Brett Stephens, and he basically points out that America is the richest country on earth, but has the saddest people. Why? They have the highest rate of depression among a survey of 14 countries. Okay? A study conducted by a Harvard Medical School, They interviewed 60,000 people worldwide, and they found that 30% of Americans, they have some sort of depression or anxiety, psychological disorder. 30%, one-third. The point is that money and hard work in this study does not buy happiness, okay? Actually, the more possessions we have, the more things we acquire, the unhappier we get, because we can never be satisfied. Second way idolatry takes place in our hearts is through exploration, through sensuality. What's another way that the Pergamon Christians committed sin? Idolatry. They sacrificed to the idol, but they also committed sexual immorality, didn't they? In the ancient world, why is idolatry always connected with sexual immorality in the Bible. Because they believe that through having sexual union with the prostitutes, that symbolized, man, this message is a little kind of steep for little young kids. Anyways, you guys came at a good time, because you can't hear this at school, right? And you sure ain't going to hear that at the KM, so you're lucky. So they came, they believed that when they are united with the temple prostitute, that they were also uniting with the God that the temple prostitute represented. It was a way to get nearer to God, okay? And so, but that symbolizes kind of like the hedonistic attitude that we have in our culture today. You know, we want pleasure. And we could be happy by, you know, seeking pleasure. And look at the sexuality, you know, it's just displayed all around, right, in our culture. So, postmodern people define happiness as hedonism, self-gratification, pleasure-seeking in one way or another. And, you know, violent crime is also rising, right? Violent crime, but why? Charles Colson, he's one of the great Christians of our time, he thinks the problem is aggravated because of self-centered, idolatrous mindset of society, self-centeredness, centered on pleasure, my own self. This is what he says. It's because of a totally self-absorbed culture that makes us believe that everything should be done the way we want it to be done, when we want it to be done, and we're entitled to everything life can give us. We don't want to wait for anything. Deferred gratification is a lost virtue. Deferred gratification is lost. It's not a virtue anymore. You know, waiting. No, just waiting. Right? We want it now. Right? And if someone gets in our way, get rid of them. Get angry. And he cites an example of road rage, you know, when he was on the road. And I can testify, in Calgary, man, I thought Canadians, man, you guys were like more polite. You know? I've had a lot of road rages, you know, targeted at me. I remember we watched a movie at Cineplex in Crawford Plaza, and I took a little bit longer than I should have coming out of the parking lot, you know, because I was waiting for actually Andrew, you know, and when I got out, the people who were waiting gave me the finger. Lucky that he wasn't a pastor. I mean, I wasn't a pastor, man. I would have went over there, and I would have, hey, Andrew, come on, man, pull up your sleeves. We're going toe-to-toe, head-to-head, man. The show what these Canadians is all about. They can't wait a few minutes for a car to pull out. But it's because we're so self-absorbed, isn't it? And the reason why idolatry cannot make us happy is because idolatry, in essence, is self-centered. Inward focus is self-absorbed. When you think about meeting your own needs, you will never meet it. You will never be satisfied. Self-absorption is not the answer. It has to be outward focus. If you want to be happy, you have to learn to be outward focused. Help people. Look out, not inward. And that's what Charles Colson says. True happiness is not achieved in inward-focused energy, but outward-focused energy. It's what the Greeks called eudaimonia. Now you're getting a Greek lesson too, guys. Before you guys go out, put $5 on the table, because this is worth more than that. Eudaimonia means virtue. True happiness is tied to virtue. You know, even as a pastor, I lose that. How important virtue is in our, you know, stuff like compassion, kindness, patience, mercy, long-suffering. It's those things that bring us true meaning and happiness in our life. What do those virtues have in common? It's outward-focused. Compassion, mercy, kindness. It's outward-focused. And you know what? I'm reminded every time I drive by here when I come to church, that King George School, they have Virtue of the Month. And I just love that. And every month, you know, it's like they have the word compassion, you know, or mercy or whatever. every time I drive out, I'm reminded, I'm like, oh yeah, I gotta be compassionate, you know. But it's a virtue. It's these things that make us happy. And Charles Colson, in his book, he has a book called My Final Word, which I borrowed from Cochrane Library. I don't want to get you to return. It's overdue. He says, he has a chapter on happiness, and he begins this chapter by saying this. He says, if we really understand the great promise that one's eternal destiny is settled with Christ, you know, our eternal destiny is settled with Christ, that understanding alone, it frees us from the tyranny of the moment, today's passion, and tomorrow's greed. I love that. It frees us from the tyranny of the moment, today's passion, and tomorrow's greed. And he goes on to describe, when he looks back on his life, what really makes him happy. It's not the Templeton Award he received at the Buckingham Palace. It's not the many honorary doctorates that he has received, and he has received many. It's not the counseling time he spent with the President of the United States in the White House, which he did many times. What he says is, what makes me happy is when I remember that I helped that prisoner in my prison ministry. When I remember that I helped that kid. When I remember when I went to my grandson who has autism to his basketball match. What makes me happy is when I remember how I helped people. And he says, what we do for the human soul is incomparably more important than what we do for the transient things of this world. This is why so many writers, T.S. Eliot, chief among them, talked about the society of permanent things. That is, the values and enduring qualities of life. These are the things that really count. Then he asks the question, have I kept faith with God's purpose in my life? Which is the ultimate question that leads toward fulfillment. Have I kept faith with God's purposes in my life? What leads us to keep the faith and purposes of God's purposes in my life? It's the Word of God. It's the Word of God. It's the gospel. True happiness comes when we are changed by the gospel, when we are changed, when the God's word allows us and helps us to serve people. And that's what the gospel does. And you remember what Jesus said, whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he is the one who loves me. He who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and show myself to him. He who has my commandments, my word, and does them. But what does he say next? A new commandment. What is his commandment, right? What does he command us to do? You love one another as I have loved you. And that's the gospel. I have loved you, Jesus says, on the cross. And my commandment is, you know why this is a new commandment? It's because it's not to love another just as I see fit, you know? How we all think we should love one another. No. What he's saying is, I'm going to show you how to love. It's a new command because I'm going to show you a new way to love. You know, as he died on the cross, as he paid for our sins on the cross, as he gave himself for us on the cross, self-sacrificially, I want you to love. And we cannot add anything to this gospel to make us happy because Jesus, he alone is our salvation. He completed the salvation, right? His words alone give us eternal life. Because it is his grace that we need. And we need to receive his grace in order to give grace. We need to receive his love in order to give love. We need to receive his service in order to serve others. And if you believe in Jesus as your Savior, that he has loved you, he has served you on the cross, that he has laid down his life for you on Calvary, not Calgary, but Calvary, to pay the price for our sin, then that's what we will do. So, I've just talked about the wrong way of seeking happiness. What is the right way of seeking happiness? It's not to try to earn it ourselves, or to try to experience and explore more things but to look solely at the Word of God, to look to Jesus, and to allow Christ to change our hearts. We need to be changed. Our character. To love others as we receive what Jesus has done for us on the cross. There's nothing more that needs to be done. And this is the gospel. There's nothing more that needs to be done. Yet we think we need to do more. We think the gospel is not enough. So we battle, we fight, instead of surrendering to Christ. Completely, surrendering completely to Christ. And so Jesus tells the church to repent, and to repent means to change. And the question is Christ enough? You know, we just sang that song. In your life, is He enough? Is His Word enough for you? Or do you feel you need to add more things around and in and around your life? You know? I need to send my son to a better school, or that's something I'm dealing with these days, but the key to change is to identify the idols of our hearts and get rid of them. And Richard Keys, in his essay, The Idol Factory, says, all sorts of things are potential idols. If this is so, how do we determine when something is becoming or has become an idol? As soon as our loyalty to anything leads us to disobey God, we're in danger of making it an idol. So an idol can be a physical object, a property, a person, an activity, a role, an institution, a hope, an image, an idea, a pleasure, or even a hero. So the problem occurs when we look to something besides Christ for our happiness. Then we have been worshiping an idol and rejecting the true God. And therefore we need to repent. We need to repent because the idols are keeping us from the blessings that Christ wants us to give to us. True peace and true contentment. We need to repent because these idols keep us. Now, what does Christ promise? To the one who conquers, I will give some of the hidden manna, and I will give him a white stone with a new name written on the stone, and no one knows except the one who receives it. When we get rid of all the idols, you know, just forget about everything. Forget about money. Give it to me. Forget about pleasure. Just take all, whatever it is you think is going to make you happy, just take it away. Focus on Jesus, His Word, and His promise in the gospel. And what does He promise to give? He promised to give the hidden manna. Now, manna was the food that God provided to the people of Israel when they were in the desert. Okay? It's food that we can't make for ourselves. Okay, it's satisfaction for life we cannot conjure in no way in this earth. It's only something that God can give. Only God can give it. You cannot find it on your own on this earth. No matter where you dig, no matter what you do. It's manna. And manna is the only thing that's going to satisfy your soul. And it's hidden manna, because why? You can't find it. It's in heaven. God has it. He says, if you trust me, if you trust my son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, and if you surrender to him your whole life, I'm going to give it to you. And you'll see, and you'll taste, and you'll be satisfied. You know, Jesus talked about, he said he's the living water. Once you drink from me, once you drink from the water that I give you, you will never thirst. Right? To the Samaritan woman. And what did the Samaritan woman, what kind of life was she living? Right? A loose life. She had four husbands. Wow, what a woman. Right? But she was not, why did she have five, four, five, six, whatever husbands she had? She wasn't satisfied. Jesus said, if you drink the water that I give you, you'll be satisfied. The hidden manna. True contentment, you know? True satisfaction. Secondly, and the thing is, we're trying to be satisfied by a lot of things except God. That's why we're never satisfied. You know, whatever it is, I don't know what it is in your life, you know. We're trying to fill it. What we need is Christ. We need to surrender to Christ and the word of Christ. Second thing that Christ promised to give is the white stone with the new name carved in it. This is a promise, new name, new. A name in the ancient world is tied to their character. How many of you guys want to be changed? Am I the only one? Man, I want so much to change. You know, there's so much junk in me that I want it gone. You know, but I'm still a work in progress. And Jesus promised, I'm going to make you a new person. There's going to be a new name on this stone. Okay? A new character. Someone worthy of what? You know, the stone, this stone was used for two things in the ancient world. Number one, it was used as a voting stone, a white stone. This was used as a voting stone in court. So when you were in court, if the jury dropped a black stone into the urn, that means you're guilty. White stone means you're not guilty. You're forgiven. Okay, you're accepted. It's a stone of acquittal, right? What does that show us? It shows us that God, He takes away our junk. He gives us a new character, forgives our sins, and gives us peace. You know, in Christ, He gives us peace, the kind of peace that the world cannot give. New character and new peace. Another way that this stone was used was that it was used as a token into a banquet. And that's what it symbolizes. This stone is a token into the kingdom of God. The privileged kingdom of God, Jesus says, you're in. Okay? God promises to give us true peace and true contentment. If we would trust Him. Now make Christ our all in all. The key is to get rid of the add-ons. You know, like in the computer, there's so many, like, when you go into the web browsers, all these add-ons, you know. Just get rid of the add-ons. Close them out. But they lead to another window. Close them out. Get rid of all the add-ons in our life. And just allow the gospel, just allow Christ, allow God. Because He has so much love, you know. He has so much blessing and love He wants to pour out. But all these add-ons, trying to fill, getting in the way. He can't fill us. He can't pour out His blessing, right? Trust only in Jesus for our salvation. And receive His blessing, okay?